It's too late. It is finished. It is finished. We are June 12th. Fabulous day, 2013. And we have been making so much progress. We need to continue to tack on even greater depth of clarity. Same setting, new information. In fact, a tremendous breakthrough today. Welcome to the video. How to explain the turnaround, 180 degree turnaround. At the end of this video, I will attach a narrative that I was taped while driving on a MP3 recorder, which gives a live version of this breakthrough. So I will just introduce the material of this breakthrough. It is absolutely incredible, really incredible. So don't give up your efforts. You don't know what you can do until you just give it everything you've got. The breakthroughs can be something that you didn't even think about, which was the case here. I simply kept trying and trying today. I woke up saying, that's it. Too late. Anything arises to bother me, I say, you're too late. You're too late. Too late. Too late. That's it. So I kept working on that during the daytime. And then I said, well, you know, is there anything more than that? And that's when the breakthrough happened. And it's incredible. It's still very, very, very early. It's like a plant has broken through the crust of the, you know, of the soil. And it's still very early. But I certainly was aware in a sort of a distant, diffuse way of moving towards happiness. Real happiness, not the kind of happy, not human happiness, real happiness. So, to set the stage, we have been working with the idea of June 30th being a very crucial day, very crucial day. We want to be very much in a positive frame of mind by that day. Very sure of ourselves, very certain we want to really have reached the top of the mountain by June 30th. So that gives us 18 days. And so I still have my work cut out for me. I know everybody else does too. But what I'm seeing is there is definitely a breakthrough is possible. A breakthrough is possible. And I experienced moving into that, the territory of that breakthrough afterwards, which is now. I feel normal, everything's fine. Nothing really different. Just ended up, just finished cooking dinner and eating dinner, and we've cleaned up, and beautiful, beautiful day in California, 84 degrees, silent, still evening, warm, perfect day. So as far as how I feel now, there's a little bit of excitement, but mellow. There's reverberation going on. So this big push to get through May and then in June go sprint, all out sprint, is certainly paying dividends. As I have suggested that we all do, is to try our best at this time. Try our best, which is why I'm making so many videos. This is an all-out push, and we need it. When we look back in hindsight, we will say, oh, thank God I put on that big push in June to get to June 30th. Thank God. That was the best thing I ever did. Guaranteed that that's how we'll look at it, because I don't want to get into the scenario that's happening, but it's a dark one. And the breakthrough is to say to all that darkness, sorry, but you're too late. You're too late. You missed me. It's too late. Game is over. Checkmate. And that's it. You will have left the field of misery by that time. You will be in the field of happiness. You will be experiencing this incredible, radiant richness. And the drama of darkness will simply be too late. Showed up too late. We outran it. Showed up too late. Because as it tries to pull you down from the mountaintop, you cannot be pulled down anymore. You reached a condition that cannot be pulled down into misery anymore. And you just say to the demons that are clawing at you and trying to grab all of you, and they say, it's too late. Can't touch me. It's too late. So this attitude, it's too late. Asserting this attitude, declaring it, is incredible what it does. And who would think of doing that, just taking this just attitude of just informing the world. Whatever arises in me now, I just say, hey, too late. Too late. If it is not some sublime happiness, I say, you're too late. Checkmate's already happened. You're too late. Nothing I can do for you. Nothing I can do for you. You had your chance. You missed it, and now you're too late. The ship has sailed. The ship has sailed. The ship has sailed. You're too late. I just say that the ship has sailed. You're too late. So imagine yourself on a ship, and it is moving out from the dock, and all these gangster people, gangsters are coming, running up to the dock, or all sorts of different people, shouting out, hey, you know, and yelling various things to you. Why don't you, I need help, come back, or we got this for you, you know. All this marketing, everything's going on, marketing to you. And you just say, sorry folks, you're too late. You missed the boat. You missed the boat. You're too late. Goodbye. Goodbye. You're too late. And you're on the boat, and they're on the dock. And what can you do? Say, hey, I can't do anything for you. You're too late. So whatever shows up in your mind right now, other than sublime happiness, a blossoming of sublime happiness, you simply say, sorry, but you're too late. The ship has sailed. The ship has already sailed. This ship has already sailed. And I get into that in the live narration as it was happening. You will see. It's pretty amazing stuff. I think on the entire spiritual path, it is the most profound time I've had, because I could begin to feel liberation, freedom. I began to realize I was on that ship, the ship of happiness, and it was pulling away from the dock. And I'm just saying, hey, everybody shows up. Nothing I can do for you now. You missed the boat. It's too late. You were too late. It's sailed. This boat has already sailed. This boat has already sailed. And I said, I'm okay. I'm okay with that. No problem. No worries. So this is something that can be done. It is a remarkably effective declaration. What you do is you put yourself as if this is the situation you're actually in, as if, and you just act that way and feel that way. Don't argue. Don't ask. Don't say, bring it up for discussion. Like, well, are you too late? I think you might be too late. What do you think? Are you too late? No. It's a declaration of, you're too late. That's it. Nothing more to say. You're too late. You're too late. You're too late. You missed the boat. You missed the boat. Nothing more to say. You missed the boat. Checkmate. Game is over. So I'm just giving you a look at afterwards, after realizing that we can move into new territory of genuine spiritual happiness, genuine spiritual bliss. That it doesn't undo us, it doesn't overwhelm us or anything. I'm fine. I'm fine. No real discernible difference. So it's something that is like smooth. It's like a huge cruise ship slowly moving away from the dock. There's not all this huge turbulence, etc. It's a smooth kind of thing. But you realize slowly you're moving away from the dock. Slow, like here's the cruise ship is slowly moving away from the dock like that. So you notice that you're in a situation like you are leaving behind the unhappiness, misery, very slowly, quite slowly. But it begins to dawn. It's like the dawn, the dawn. It's like experiencing the dawn. It's as if I experienced the beginning of dawn. I looked around and you see, oh, there's a little glimpse, over there. It's the darkness, the curtain of darkness is starting to lift. It's like that. I didn't know if I'd ever see the day. But by being faithful and following along this time frame and making the push, all these all-out efforts, here it comes, here it comes. And I would say ever so gently, ever so gently. It doesn't intrude upon your functionality at all. And yet, if I really put my mind to it, I can feel a reverberation, deep down reverberation of that this is it. This is it. And as I explained, the key was seeing that our perception is really neutral, like a mirror. It's the mind that interprets perception. And our mind is imagining boundaries, real boundaries, thingness on perception. It's the mind that is projecting that for the purpose of this training exercise of trying to teach spirit how to die. And that this thingness that's projected on everything is just made up. It's just a belief. It's not actually there. So we think that we're seeing things. We think we're seeing things. But we can also think that we're not seeing things, that we're seeing oneness. So, but having seen that, I'm no longer so mental about it. There's a new phase now. Let me say this. New phase is experiencing now. It's no longer so mental as far as explaining the details. Once you get hooked and you see it, once you come face to face, then the door to experience can open. So I would say that we're heading towards experiencing this point, and we don't have to get over the mental. When I try to explain, I feel a little bit like I'm getting slightly off the track now, where it's like two road. It's like you go along a road, and then it sort of branches a little bit, and one road goes up, up into the highlands or something, which is experiencing. So, we will certainly see how that goes. At the same time, I want to provide some content for people. But as the experiencing starts to happen, some viewers will drop away and some new ones will come in because there will be nowhere to hide. I no longer will be providing a hiding place to hide from enlightenment. It will be experienced, directly experienced. Words give a nice place to hide from enlightenment. Very nice. But that's the price we pay. So I don't know what's next. I don't know what's next. We will find out what's next. I'm sort of stopping my following of the world at this point. I'm not turning on the radio, and I'm not watching television, except if I'm cooking dinner, I'll watch a Giants game if it's on. And that's about it. And I'm not looking at the news on the internet or the newspaper. I try not to. I'm not really following anything at this point. I've decided it's time to put on an all-out sprint now. Can we get to experiencing? Can we get to what we call enlightenment? Or as I say now, can we allow enlightenment to get to us? Because that's actually the case. Can we allow ourselves to be caught by enlightenment? And so, without further ado, let me introduce this audio clip, which I'll put some accompanying pictures or something with it. It's while driving, so there's the road noise. But I think you'll be able to make out the audio from it. And this is the realization here of being caught by enlightenment. So, here we go. Enjoy the clip. What I've been saying today is that it's too late. Everything that arises, I say it's too late. It's too late. Too late. Checkmate. It's already happened. And what does this mean? It's too late. Too late for this to arise. Too late for any troubles anymore. It's all too late. It's finished. Because I have seen that perception is not set. Perception is really just what we make of it. We can use perception to see thingness, or we can use perception to see no thingness. And that is the crucial insight. Once we see that, it's all over. It's finished. Anything that tries to come up and seize you, it's too late. It's too late. Plain and simple. It's too late. It is literally too late. Because we have the key component, which is perception. And we see that the mind is making thingness out of it. In order to help the spirit try to prepare for the start of time. But there isn't really thingness at all. Mind is simply interpreting what perception is showing as thingness. It's mind that's doing the interpreting. It's not perception. Perception itself is neutral. It doesn't know what it's seeing. Like a mirror is neutral. It doesn't know what it's seeing. So it's mind that is deciding that there's definitions out there that to define, to name, to define, to separate, to fragment, to see things, boundaries, borders. It's mind that is doing that. Mind can change by spirit giving mind a new idea of let's prepare to step into timelessness. And then mind can then use perception, the mirror, and it sees no thingness, no real boundaries. No real definitions. Only one. only one seamlessness, no thingness. It's been said that the vision of nothing, but it's really no thingness, vision of no definitions, no definitions of things. All is seen as one, vision of oneness. So as soon as we see that this perception is not dictating to us whether it's thingness or no thingness, and it's really comes from the mind, and that we are in control of the mind, what the mind presents, then it's all over. It's too late for confusion to get a hold of us anymore. Essentially, it's done. Because the door has been seen. The door is now recognized as a door. And on one side of the door, we see it's on one side, and on the other side of the door, we see it's on the other side of the door. And it's the game of delay. It's too late for the game of delay at this point. Can't play the game anymore. Game's over. Game is over. So that's simply what I've been telling everything that arises in my mind. I just say, hey, the game is over. It's too late. It's finished. And just turn my attention away from it. Don't engage it. Don't argue. Don't do anything. I just say, it's too late for this. It's literally too late for this. It's finished. Enlightenment is now right here. There's no escaping it. There's no escaping enlightenment at this point. It's inescapable. So for me, I can say that now enlightenment is inescapable. It has me in its jaws, so to speak, which is okay. I've been caught. Enlightenment has caught me. And I can see that I've been lassoed. I can see that resistance is futile. Escape is not possible. At this point, escape is no longer possible from enlightenment. We cannot avoid it any longer. So we can say enlightenment is now inescapable. For me, it's inescapable. And this is the declarations that I'm now making. I started out the day by saying, it's too late. It's too late. It's over. It's too late for anything to interfere. And now I'm saying, yeah, enlightenment is, for me, is unavoidable at this point. Inescapable. And that carries a tremendous weight to it. Enlightenment is unavoidable. Inescapable now. It's got me. So there is a movement now towards the surrender to the inevitable. Surrender to the inevitable. And that is, everything is pivoted now. Instead of searching for enlightenment, I've now been caught by enlightenment. See, all this so-called searching was really not searching at all. It was hiding. It was hiding from enlightenment. But now the hiding is futile. You know, it's like hide and seek. When you get found, when you've been found, you've been found. It's that kind of feeling. Hide and seek is some, you know, everybody goes hide. Somebody closes their eyes and they count to 100. And then they go looking for people, looking for where you're hiding. And then when you're hiding somewhere and the seeker comes and finds you,
Game's up. They know where you are now. They know where you are. And you know that you've been found. So that's how I feel. I feel like I've been found. Enlightenment has found me. Resistance is futile. No more, you know, it's... So this is a very interesting take on it. Sort of pivoting everything 180 degrees. Instead of me desperately tracking down an elusive enlightenment, it's now changed entirely where it's enlightenment tracking down an elusive willingness that's been desperately hiding here and there. All, of course, rationalizing this as spiritual seeking, seeking enlightenment. What do you, you know, I say, what am I doing? Oh, well, I'm seeking enlightenment here. This is why I'm here. This is why I'm looking here. I'm looking, desperately looking for enlightenment here. All the while, of course, it's providing a place of hiding from enlightenment. So just this declaration, enlightenment's got me now. It's got me. It's an amazing declaration. It brings a true wow factor to it, which is what we're looking for in declarations. It's something that just really is a game changer. Declarations should be a game changer for you. Feel like you can should feel like, wow, this is a game changer for me. It really is. So, in this perspective, I just wait on enlightenment to reel me in. I'm hooked. I'm caught. A fish that's been hooked. The hook is seeing that perception is has no qualities of its own. It does not have a mind of its own. And that this thingness we're seeing is completely made up by the mind. It's not there. It's a belief system. It's a belief by the mind. It's just a belief. We're so used to thinking that everything out there has independent qualities. They're somehow separate from the whole, from the wholeness of it all, from the oneness of it all. This is made up by the mind. It's not really there. We assume, we are just assuming it's there. So, this is heavyweight stuff. That enlightenment has got me. I'm in its sights now. It sighted me. It knows. It set the hook. I can't wiggle free of that hook. That's why I say to all those who say, come hide with me, come hide with me. I say, you know what? It's too late. All these thoughts that are arising, scenarios in the mind, are really your old buddies, your hiding buddies, who say, are whispering to you, say, hey, I know a good place to hide. And I just say to them, hey, it's too late. I've been found out. It's too late for me now. I can't hide anywhere anymore. It's not possible. And they kind of say, oh, you know, you're no fun. So the cat's out of the bag and my cover is blown. You know, my cover has been blown. Enlightenment has found me. The cover that I was, you know, the undercover efforts that we're making has now, I've finally been found out. And, you know, so how does it feel? Fine. Kind of a little bit thrilling. Uh, The feeling is one that I really want. It's anticipation. That something truly incredibly great is coming for me. So-called fun of hiding, which is really incredible misery, it's over. Game's up. Checkmate. I've been checkmated. Enlightenment has checkmated me. And so now I've been captured. I've been captured by enlightenment. I made a valiant effort to avoid it, but the effort has come to an end. So I have to accept the consequences. Of course, those consequences may be quite wonderful. Will be quite wonderful. But people will no longer see me as a hiding buddy, someone to hide with. Not at all. They'll say, "Ooh, I can't hide with him. You know, the enlightenment will find me right away. I can't hide with him." So those who want to hide will, of course, you know, will scurry away like cockroaches to, you know, find some dark hiding place. They don't want to hang out with me, that's for sure. So really, these are the finest moments of my life here. Just being reeled in. I saw that our perception is not seeing thingness of itself. It's the mind that is superimposing this interpretation. That's when the hook set, and I said, "Oh!" I jumped, suddenly shocked, like, "Oh my gosh!" I realized that's it. That's it. It's like a fish being hooked. They gobble the lure, and then suddenly they feel the hook, and they say, "Uh-oh, what's that?" Of course, in this case, it's not painful or frightening or anything, but it's like a little bit, "Huh?" I realize, "Oh, I'm hooked." So what I'm doing now in my mind, in my spirit, is preparing for happiness. I realize that suffering is going to be leaving me now. It's too late for suffering. It's going to be leaving. And saying goodbye to all those old accomplices. Time to say goodbye to all the old acquaintances of suffering. And for me, it's suffering is over. Suffering and darkness and all, it's over. So I'm you know, adjusting my expectations to that now. I'm now realizing that this is true. So this is the point I've always wanted to get to. So I'm happy to be here. And working on making a conscious effort to welcome back happiness. I'm being pulled into the land of happiness at this point. It's funny because the truck I was following as I'm driving is said in the back of it, big letters, Valhalla. the paradise. Valhalla. I was following that all the way down. So I'm being reeled into paradise at this point. So my expectations are shifting from expecting terrible suffering, putting up with all this anxiety and horrible fatigue and all this stuff. Now I'm accepting the fact that all of that is going to be gone, and all that is going to be replaced with bliss and tremendous brightness and felicity and calm and assurance and certitude, all of that. Just a whole constellation of extreme positive feelings are on their way now. So it's like going out of a dense, cold fog into beautiful, sparkling sunlight. You know, you have to adjust your expectation to say that this is what's coming. So, I know it's coming. And I'm not fighting against it. I'm welcoming. I'm throwing out the welcome mat. And today has been a day unlike any other, actually. I was extremely tired. I didn't sleep last night. So much terrible back pains, but I was foggy, and my mind was so fogged up, and my psyche was so diffuse and undefined, and I felt I was in transition, a tremendous transition. And it's true. That's absolutely the case. So it was hard to function today, that is for sure. I'm glad the day is almost over here. Very, very difficult to function today. I didn't even know if I could. Extremely slow on the uptake. I could hardly see my eyes. Everything, was just judging everything visually. All my senses were just dull. And I was just in kind of a limbo state, almost. It's a transitional state. I'm saying goodbye to the freakish suffering. All bad things must come to an end. That is a fact. All bad things must come to an end. All suffering must come to an end. It's too late for tears over it. So I'm returning to the land of the living, is what's happening. I am returning to the land of the living, coming out of the land of the dead, where I've been hiding. So enlightenment is going to drag me into the land of the living. That is true. Yesterday I had a sudden realization. I was in a Thai restaurant, and I had a sudden realization that the game is up. My cover, I'm willing to have my cover blown. I suddenly realized, I said, my cover is going to be blown. Meaning my hiding, I won't be able to hide anymore. My hiding days are all finished. And I felt all right with it. I felt resigned to it. I said, you know what, it's okay. Whereas before, no, I didn't want my cover blown. I always said, no, I was fiercely protective of my cover. And then yesterday, suddenly, it was okay. I said, you know what? That's fine. That's fine with me. I'm ready to have my cover blown. Go ahead. Let's have my cover blown. So What's the cover? Well, that enlightenment, that enlightenment can't find me. I'm able to hide from it. That's my cover. Hiding from enlightenment, but that's no longer going to be possible. So, of course, people will see that, and it will be known. You know, I won't be able to hide it. I've been caught. Once you get caught by enlightenment, you can't hide the fact. It's over. Hiding is over. So I said, oh, okay, well, that's it. My cover's been blown. And like, if you're undercover and your cover's blown, that's it. You can't go undercover anymore. So I can't, like, hang out with hiders, you know, because previously I could hang out with all the hiders and say, why are you hiding? What? And find out the whole scoop about why they're hiding and how they hide and all this stuff. Whereas now, won't be able to do that. Won't be able to hang out with the hiders because they won't hang out with me. They say, oh no, man, if we hang out with you, we're going to get found. We don't want to get found. And it's a very interesting thing that the last couple days I've noticed that people are just like staring at me. It's happened before? No. Gawking, staring. I don't know why. It's kind of weird. I just sort of like all sorts of different types of people. I walk into a room and people just like looking at me like there's something wrong with me or they don't, I don't know what it is that they're seeing. But it kind of, I get a little self-conscious about it. I'm getting a little self-conscious. Not much, but I think that, I say, that's odd. I mean, I look in the mirror, is there something, you know, something wrong where I look? Or why are people staring at me? I don't know. They're seeing something. So I realize something's going on. It's just too strong of a situation where normally people don't stare, even especially in close situations, they don't just stare at you and don't make eye contact. They're, I don't know what they're staring at. So there's must be something. Maybe enlightenment is close by, and it's ready to pounce on me. And maybe people are seeing that, picking it up or something. I don't know. Maybe I'm the last to know, but the last will be first. I feel the same. I feel the same. I don't feel any different. In fact, I feel more tired and stressed out. And Croatia. Where's Croatia? I don't know. I had a dream maybe a week or so ago. It got to be the worst dream I've ever had. One of the worst. It was just horrible. My God. I don't want to get into it, but the upshot of it is that there was some sacrifice, human sacrifice was taking place, and everybody was in on it. And we were all being taken to this room to witness this horrible torture and sacrifice. And the sacrificial victim was Croatia. It was named Croatia. It was just the... Oh my God, it was so horrible. But, for me, it's too late. It's too late. It's too late for fear. Too late for suffering. Too late for misery. I think I saw what that dream showed me was the world. What's going to happen with the world? So all these people, and we're all in very dark. But we look inky darkness. the way we looked. We're on this transport. We've been taken somewhere. We're all huddled together in this icy, dark, extreme fear. Icy cold fear. Just shaking and trembling with horrible dread, because we didn't want to see what's going to happen. We're being forced to witness the most horrible torture and execution and sacrifice. That was a terrible, terrible, nasty dream. And at that point, that's when I really put on a big, big push and saying, no, Enlightenment is going to catch me. I'm going to come out of hiding, as it were. Say, hey, Enlightenment, here I am. I don't know where Croatia is. It's somewhere by Greece and Macedonia, you know, somewhere like there. It's in the Balkans. It's in the Balkans. So I guess that something is going to happen in the Balkans, as it usually does. That's going to stir it all up. But it's too late for me. I'm going to miss it. I'm going to miss that. I'm going to miss the conflict. Oh well. That's how the cookie crumbles. Just like I stopped watching the baseball yesterday. I said, it's too late. That's it. And I guess there was some incredible brawl that took place. And I missed it. I didn't see it. I didn't see highlights. Nothing. And everyone's taught today's take. Oh, did you see that brawl? Oh, my gosh. You know, I said, oh, yeah. I just kind of said, yeah. I didn't see it. And I said, oh, well, I missed it. You know, this is supposed to be a real, real incredible brawl. With all the managers and coaches getting into it. It's just, you know, and so... But I missed it. I missed it because I decided that very day I wasn't watching anymore. I mean, I'm not going to focus in anymore on that. It's too late for that. It's too late. Too late because now enlightenment's got me. And I won't be able to focus in on those things anymore. Because the bliss will be too prevalent to really not notice it. So again, it's too late for all that stuff. So I missed the big brawl. I missed the big brawl in the world, too. Well, oh well. That's the price you pay. When you get caught by enlightenment, that's the price you pay. But that's okay. Doesn't feel like a big deal to miss out on that kind of stuff. All right, there you go. There you have it. There's the recording. Wonderful recording here.
So that was it. That was it. Now, a couple of points need to be made. The key issue is to recognize, to submit to your catcher. You've been captured by enlightenment. You can't do anything about it. And you're in its clutches. So all you can do is just abide in it. Enjoy it. You cannot describe it. You cannot define it. You cannot replicate it. Resistance is futile. So, what I'm seeing here is that the play, the dance of the sublime dance of beauty, it changes. And the key thing is, don't try to define it. Don't try to get into your mind and say, okay, try to remember. Don't try to remember it. Don't try to remember it. Just accept it. Whatever is coming, just accept it. Don't try to take a photograph of it. Don't try to run off and put it in a book. Don't try to say what it is or what it reminds you of. Don't try to sketch it. Don't try to paint it. Don't try to put it to music. Stay in the now with it. sort of tell yourself, I'm helpless to do anything about this. I can't do anything with it. I'm helpless. I can't do anything with this. Nothing I can do with this. I'm a captive. I'm a captive audience. I've been captivated. I'm a captivated audience. Because keep in mind that this is prepping us to step into timelessness, to shed all definitions, to drop all definitions. So the last thing we want to do is to try to delineate and define the experiences that we're having. That would be contra purposes, at cross purposes. So those who have experienced this are experiencing it no better than to ask somebody, what are you experiencing? What's going on with you? Oh no. Because that would bring in definition. Oftentimes people say, well, there's a sense of spaciousness or a sense of this, something like that. But it's very vague. The last thing anyone wants to do is to try and define it. It's really non-definition, prepping for non-definition. So there's a morphing that's taking place, as it were, that what I am experiencing, things seem ephemeral. There's an ephemeral quality to it. A delicate, ephemeral quality that easily, there can be a smooth, quick transition from one type of presentation to another. That's the point of it. The point of it is to wean us away from definition, from boundaries, from trying to say, this is what this is, this is particularly this, and by all these thises, and trying to define ourselves as something, as having boundaries, etc. So any and all visuals and can appear. And it seems like the imagination is incredible. It is. Do not try to label it. Don't label it. Don't label it. Avoid labeling it. Even with colors. Don't label the colors. Don't try to describe it. Don't try to symbolize it. Don't try to define it. Now, we're so used to this that we might be afraid. We're having all these visuals, all this incredibly ephemeral, beautiful arisings in our mind, and we might feel like, oh, I need to build a boat, you know. But no, just abide in it. And don't ask for any particular experience. Just let whatever comes. Kind of like watching a river. Let whatever flows down the river, just you're just watching it. Again, above all else, don't label it. Don't try to grab a hold of it. Don't try to grab a hold of anything. Imagine you're in a straitjacket. You're restrained. Enlightenment has captured you. It puts you in the padded cell. You're in a straitjacket. You're restrained. Nothing you can do. You just sit there and get tortured by this sublime beauty. Of course, it's not torture. But you cannot speak it, you cannot explain it, you cannot define it, you cannot represent it. You're powerless to do all of that. Just imagine this, that you're powerless to do anything except abide in it, enjoy it, abide in it. You're not going to be tested on it. This is the exercise. I am powerless to do anything about this. All I can do is simply be aware of it. I can't even direct what's going to come down the river next. Imagine on a hillside overlooking this beautiful river, and down this beautiful river are floating these floats. Incredible floats of all varieties, vast costumes, so many costumes and songs and colors and banners, and every possible thing is floating down this river. And you up on the hill, you can't do anything about it. You're just watching it. You shout out, but they don't hear you. There's nobody around to talk to. You have no writing utensils. And so you just say, I'm just going to enjoy what flows down the river. This is real meditation. This is really, it's preparing for a step into timelessness is what it is, which is ultimately results in dropping all definition, all attempts to define. And from that, we simply abide in being, which is reality, which is beyond definition, cannot be defined. But meanwhile, we continue to allow this preparation to go forward. So try to say that I have no expectations what will come down the river next. And I cannot control what comes down the river. I can't stop what comes down the river. Whatever comes, comes. I'm just here. I can't move. I can't do anything. So I might as well enjoy it. Might as well enjoy what comes down the river. So we can get ourselves into this mindset, which most people will rebel against it because they don't have the context to understand why we're doing this. And they'll say, oh, no, it's too much control. Oh, no, it's not. It's intentional. Intentionally putting ourselves, we're prepping for timelessness, we're prepping the drop definition. And so we're intentionally saying we're powerless to control this experience. We can't stop it, we can't start it, we can't do anything about it, we cannot describe it or define it, we cannot define it at all, we cannot define it, we're not going to even try to define it. And when we get into that allowance, then the sublime begins to dance. The ephemeral sublime begins to dance for us. That frees us from the dance of deception, from the dance of the simulation of time, from the dance of the flesh. It's that which frees us from it. So the dance of the sublime begins. And we consciously allow it its freedom from definition. That is our gift to ourselves. So really we're giving a great gift to ourselves. We say, we will not transpose this, we will not define it. I will not compose a symphony based on the dance of the sublime. I will not try to do anything with it. I will not try to represent it. I will not try to replicate it. I will not try to record it. I can record just this body sitting here, but I won't try to take a photograph of it, try to find it. I won't try to make an image of it. I won't try to spin off my imagination from it. I'll just let it dance. I'll just watch the dance. And the great step forward that this is we go past the mind's, the ego trying to shame us and say, oh, you're selfish, you're not sharing. The entire purpose is to try not to define it. Leave it undefined. That is the sharing. Because in doing that, we're sharing ourselves with reality. Because remember, we are trying to define ourselves. And we're trying to do this by defining, projecting this desire for definition out onto this mirror, and then saying that there's things, there's definitions, there's boundaries. Here's where one thing stops and here's where something else starts. And by surrounding ourselves with these definitions, we feel that we ourselves are defined. So in reversing this, we try to forego defining what we are experiencing, so that we ourselves begin to feel that what we are is not defined, is undefinable, beyond definition. That is the whole point to it. So we're really sharing truth with everyone. We're sharing ourselves with everyone by not defining it. So to be kind to others, say, don't ask them to define their experiencing. Don't ask them to represent it. Don't ask others to to inspire you, to be, you know, be a source of inspiration to you. Because the dance of the sublime happens for us, each one of us, when we allow it to. So we're really moving into new territory here. No question, it's been moved into before, but right now in this world, we always have to take a fresh approach depending on the times that we live in. We still have to make that fresh push, that fresh approach into acceptance of all this, into seeing it clearly. In other words, we have to come face to face with that. We're not reading about it in some history book. We're coming face to face to it. So allow this flow of the sublime. Just allow the river to flow. Allow this river to flow. Don't try to stop the river from flowing. So the future is bright. The future is tremendous. The future is splendid. The future is splendid. All right, we will go into that future right now.